Hello and welcome to a new edition of the Observer Research Foundation's Fellow Seminar Series. Today, we will be discussing Abhijit Mukhopadhyay's paper titled Post-Pandemic Economic Recovery, Seven Priorities for India, in which he has outlined a seven-point fiscal stimulus path that can catalyze economic recovery in India. Abhijit is Senior Fellow with ORF's Economy and Growth Program. His main areas of research include macroeconomics and public policy, with core research areas in monetary economics and the political economy of finance. Today, we're very happy to be joined by two experts who will be sharing their thoughts, insights, and perspectives on Abhijit's paper. I'd like to extend a special welcome to Professor Moshami Das, who is professor at IES Unit, Institute of Economic Growth, and faculty member at the Delhi School of Economics. Her area of specialization is economic growth and development. As a former student of yours at DSE, I'm absolutely thrilled to welcome you to this discussion, ma'am. I would also like to extend a very warm welcome to Mr. Roshan Kishore, who is the data and political economy editor at the Hindustan Times. He's an economist by training and has been a visiting fellow at Center for the Advanced Study of India, University of Pennsylvania. We're delighted to be joined by you, Roshan, and really look forward to hearing your views on the topic. So the paper that we're discussing today examines the pre-pandemic slowdown and subsequent contraction in the Indian economy. Utilizing an analysis of broad macroeconomic and sectoral fundamentals, the paper argues that a notable lack of consumption and investment demand had already persisted before the pandemic. COVID-19 heightened those trends. Henceforth, India's economic revival will be crucially dependent on demand generation by direct government fiscal intervention. With this context being set, I'd now like to invite Abhijit to present his paper. Over to you, Abhijit.
You know, without wasting any time, you know, I'll immediately start because the main background is the pandemic, of course. You know, everybody knows about it. And then during the most part of April, May, there was this lockdown, and because of that, there was in the first quarter, there was a staggering 23.9% kind of a contraction, which continued in the second quarter as a much moderate, minus 7.5%. But even before pandemic, because there has been, the trends actually suggest the existence of lack of demand in the economy. If we go by the very basic and the broad fundamentals of macroeconomic fundamentals of the economy, a reopened economy, of course, in the, we all know that the festive months of October and November obviously give a spark to all kinds of consumption and pent up demand, probably also because of the, reopening. But then there is always a possibility those may disappear in the subsequent months. And there are a certain kind of indications, particularly in the November IIP figures, which may not be that well. Then the general assumption till now from the government side or the Ministry of Finance side is that there will be an automatic kind of a recovery which will be made. But I'll be extremely happy, if that actually happens. But then the point is that if it does not happen, then what will happen? Then we don't have a plan B. So then in that kind of a situation, economy ultimately may land in a phase of prolonged stagnation or even, a bit of contraction at some phases. So this is what it is all about, due to the simply because of the fact that the paper has been put into the long review process. But when actually I started writing it, I had only first quarter data for this fiscal, but now we have second quarter. But more or less the broader observations, they don't change. And then the major point is that ultimately, even if we leave aside the, first quarter figure, even then we can see that even before pandemic, the simple linear trend line was falling down. So you know, going back to the very basic idea of national income identity, which is also the aggregate demand equation in a way, which gives, you know, y equals to c plus I plus g plus x minus m, where y is output, c is consumption, I is investment, this is government consumption, and this is net export, export minus import. So, you know, the results which actually follow, they will immediately show that trend lines in C and I stagnated even before pandemic. Export has gone down while import has gone up before pandemic. So obviously, net export has also gone down. The only component which actually went up both before and after pandemic is the government expenditure, government consumption expenditure. So, but what is the why we are talking about this entire thing? Because this is why. Because, you know, if we look at the share of demand components from first quarter of 2011-12, then we will see that ultimately, you know, there are, this is the consumption. This is the consumption which actually somewhere around 50%, more than 50% in fact, you know, sometimes even close to 60%. And this is investment. This is more than 30%. So roughly, you know, 75 to 80% of Indian GDP is consisted of these two components. I am not undermining export in a way, but our export is also, you know, one can always argue that, you know, this is 20%. So even China has 20% kind of, you know, export share in its GDP. But then the problem is that we are not yet China. So obviously, you know, China is roughly before pandemic, it was around 14 trillion. And though we claim to be at 3 trillion, but we were actually a little bit marginally short of that figure, even in 2019, if we go by the World Bank data, adjusted by international, you know, dollar. So because of this, you know, this is the, you know, that, you know, this is what actually has happened to the consumption. So once again, if we exclude this figure, the first quarter, then before pandemic, we can clearly see that it has stagnated because, you know, it has been relatively flat. And not only that, the point is that ultimately, whenever we are, we look at the trend diagram, then obviously somewhere around 2017-18, somewhere around 2017-18, we have a situation where, you know, the things started falling. Things started falling down and then it actually went down like this. Same thing with the investment. You know, even if we look at the investment also, then investment also was the same, similar kind of a thing. And particularly if we see from this point to this point, you know, even before pandemic, it actually started. It in fact collapsed, you know, from this point one, if one can see the growth rate in investment actually collapsed from this point of time. So if we just, you know, put the summary of analysis of the aggregate demand components, then of course, you know, the consumption demand is the largest contributor. So, you know, we have to identify the fact that, you know, there is a distinct kind of a indication that ultimately there is a lack of consumption and both consumption and investment demand. And government consumption expenditure actually has risen steadily in the recent past, but then as we can see, you know, with the share also, share is somewhere around 10%, you know, maybe now it has gone up to 15-16, or maybe even, you know, now we have a reduced GDP, so as a result, of course, the proportion will rise. So but then it has got its own kind of a limits, because it cannot go beyond, you know, 16-17-18, or maybe, you know, 19%, not more than that. It cannot drive the demand. I'll be very happy if export becomes a demand driver, but I don't think that, you know, it will be able to revive GDP in the short run. You know, if we look at a kind of a, you know, couple of years, 1 year or 2 years kind of a time horizon, then obviously, you know, it is not going to happen. If the current global economic environment factors, all other factors actually remain unchanged. So I am not getting into the sectoral analysis because I don't have that much enough time, you know, that much time. But then, you know, the basic idea is that only agriculture, forestry and fishing is the only sector which is within the pandemic, after the pandemic hit, you know, that is the only sector which is doing well. And this was somewhere around even earlier also, though the growth rate is less compared to relatively to other sectors, you know, in the past. But then, of course, you know, this cannot be, we cannot think about a agricultural based economy simply because of the fact that the share of agriculture in economy is quite low. So then, you know, if we talk about services, which actually more than 50% share, you know, they contribute into the entire GDP, then financial, real estate and professional services are less badly affected during the pandemic and, you know, should recover. But then same with the construction, internal trade, tourism, transport, you know, telecom, basically all kinds of communication sectors and other kind of sectors, other kind of services sector. But here the major point is that ultimately if real sector activity sometimes, you know, get paused or, you know, get hampered, then obviously it will have its own kind of effect, particularly in the financial sector at some point of time. So we need a solid and consistent kind of a performance in the real sector economy, particularly in the manufacturing and, you know, the other sectors of the industry. So that, you know, this financial sector and other kind of, you know, services sector will also keep on flourishing. Of course, you know, once again, as we have seen that, you know, whatever is related to the government, earlier also government, as government consumption actually went up in a similar kind of a trend, we can see that electricity, gas and other public utility services and public administration and other public services, they are less affected or, you know, they are into the positive zone. But of course, you know, this cannot keep on. So what is the, you know, the entire blueprint that we are talking about? So I am here talking about the first point I am talking about is that to induce demand. The basic idea is to induce as much demand. That is point number A. And point number B is that of course, you know, this is a tough time in spite of the fact that, you know, a lot of optimism is there. Optimism is very good. There is no doubt about it. But that does not mean that people are not affected. All kinds of people from all strata of the society actually got affected. So the point B is that these people need to be supported. At least, you know, they should survive, you know, then the economy also should survive simply because of the fact that, you know, we are a consumption demand driven economy. Now, you know, I just updated the latest, basically the main point here is that we need roughly around 66 billion ton of food grains to universalize PDS for 6 months. And now if we look at the January 2021, there is a lot of, you know, unmilled paddy there. So finally, you know, we have if we add up everything, we have a 93.7 million ton kind of in the central pool. Of course, you know, there the harvesting season is over, then a lot of other kind of procurements can also happen. So obviously, you know, it will remain at the same level or maybe even go up a little bit. So it's not a very big deal to, you know, universalize the PDS. Second point is that what I propose is that ultimately, you know, one has to expand the employment guarantee to urban areas. This is very important simply because of the fact that a lot of, as we have seen during the lockdown also, a lot of, you know, migration actually happened, the reverse migration rather, I would say. And those people, some of these people, good part of these people have come back. So they also need some kind of, you know, employment in the urban areas. So that is where, in fact, this point is coming. Then definitely, you know, here we are talking about, you know, government's March package actually consisted of some direct benefit transfer to some 80 crore population. Somewhere around, you know, I don't have immediately very credible kind of data, you know, how much of the population, how much of these 80 crore actually has got this benefit. But the main point is that apart from the budgeted allocation, only somewhere around 73,000 crore was the incremental amount. And this is somewhere during the lockdown, what SBI EcoRap report estimated that 37.3 crore workers, all kinds of self-employed, casual and regular, their loss of total their total income loss was somewhere around 4 lakh crore rupees. So obviously we need more DBT covering more people. Fourth is that here, in fact, probably, you know, this is not a very immediate demand driven kind of a proposal, but this will be a supplemental kind of a, you know, support for the industry also, because some of the industries are not doing so well apart from pharma. Of course, you know, for obvious reasons, pharma is doing very well. But then, you know, the metal, oil, chemical, processed food and automobile, these are the sectors which are not doing very well. So immediately, if some input subsidy, you know, let's say for 6 months or a year, if those can be provided, and of course, you know, if one sector is doing well, then it can be taken out from this list. And then, let's say machinery and equipment, textile and electrical equipment, these kind of sectors will be replaced. This will replace those sectors which are doing actually well currently. Now, this is not much has to be said, because, you know, time and again in different kind of in academic, non-academic, semi-academic, all kinds of literature, all kinds of writing, people actually are talking about infrastructure. That is why our economy is not growing, or, you know, so many things are not happening. People are unable to get all kinds of facilities. So, you know, I am not going to elaborate on this. Then the sixth one, what I am trying to say is that there is no point, you know, getting into the entire FRBM, because the government already, you know, used the provision to breach the target twice. And this year also, now we have seen after the budget that, you know, it has gone up to 9.5% in revised estimate. So at this point of time, what I believe is that what I argued in this paper rather is that ultimately, you know, it is very important to keep the economy alive, and to keep the economy alive, this entire kind of a what do we call it, that, you know, this entire FRBM act cannot be always obeyed. Because, you know, if we keep on doing that, then obviously the economy might be in certain amount of risk. So, you know, for at least for 2 years, this FRBM can be suspended. And this is also, once again, I am not going to, you know, elaborate, but I said that ultimately, you know, a 10 lakh crore kind of a fiscal stimulus should be given, which, of course, you know, look a little bit improbable at this point of time. But anyway, and then I have given a kind of a, you know, a mixture of bond, external borrowing and some kind of monetization to, you know, raise that entire money. But anyway, the paper is in ORF online, and then anybody can look up to that. I would rather be more interested in the you know, comments provided by the panelists, both the panelists. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that insightful presentation. I think you've been able to lay out very clearly and comprehensively the contours of an economic revival in India, and also identify the steps the government should take at this critical juncture. To all our participants, please feel free to post your questions in the chat window. We will have a Q&A towards the end. Let me now invite our panelist, Professor Moshimi, to share her insights on the paper.
Thank you, Tanushree, and thank you, Abhijit. That was very nice presentation, which summarizes all your basic points that you make in the paper. I think first let me congratulate you for doing a very good job in terms of kind of, you know, giving a very broad based overlook about summary of how the economy was doing since 2012. And I think many of us have been talking about it for a long time, even before the COVID-19 crisis struck us. So in some sense, I think the main points that we have been talking about for a long time are that the economy, Indian economy, in the during the period 2012 to 2019, the period that you covered in your article, was not, the picture was not particularly rosy. And the, as you sort of, you know, laid out in the paper itself, so there were many concerns at that point of time, even before COVID. So suppose we sort of, you know, go back to, let's say, January 2020, then there were many concerns that were bothering us. One was that growth was slowing down. Second was the inflation rate was creeping up. Third was the financial sector was in turmoil, reeling under the NPA crisis. It was still reeling under the NPA crisis. And the fourth one, which I'm sure Roshan will probably talk, because, you know, so he has been written extensively about that, is that, and others, you know, many Oxfam surveys, which were pointing out towards the fact that there was rising inequality, which we have never seen before. So these were the four things that many people were, you know, many macroeconomists sitting in India and elsewhere were bothered about. And these are all sort of, you know, in some sense, these are all related. I remember at that point of time, as you also pointed out, the question was that the debate was, in some sense, you know, is it structural or is it cyclical and so on. So, and lots of articles were written at that point of time regarding trying to identify the problem. And then, of course, COVID came. So in a way, all the problems which are already there underlying the, you know, economy were sort of, you know, came to the surface with a bang, and then we, you know, we had to deal with them. So in a way, when I was reading your paper, I was trying to think that suppose what would have happened if COVID-19 crisis had not come. So suppose we were in the same position as we were in you know, January 2020, and then there was no COVID, but we are still, the economy was still the way it was, you know, very, very precarious. And I was trying to think that of your 7-point packages, you know, what are the, would they still be the kind of packages that one would argue for? And I sort of, you know, I realized that those are the exactly the same kind of package that one would still argue sitting at, you know, even if, you know, without COVID. COVID, of course, aggravated the problem. And I think the reason are the following. So think about your package, you know, first argument about, you know, first policy instrument that you want to use, universal PDS for a year. Universal PDS for a year, one would argue, even without COVID, simply because the rising mounting inequality that many people have pointed out, the reason when you say that consumption is falling, part of the reason was consumption was falling precisely because the poorer people didn't have enough money in their hand, enough resources in their hand to spend on consumption. So I think giving them access to food grains so that it, whatever meager income that they have goes into other, you know, in buying other stuff. There was a lot written about that, you know, they are not even buying biscuits. So those kind of things they can spend, and that always will have a positive impact on the manufacturing sector. So that would be, that particular prescription will go even without COVID. Expanding employment guarantee scheme to the urban areas. Again, I think, you know, that is another scheme, because as I said, that rising inequality and, you know, growing inequality between the top 10% and the bottom 40% is something that has been bothering us for a long time. So these are measures which in any case one would need, COVID or no COVID, to sort of, you know, as a basic social security measure, forget about growth, forget about recovery. These are needed whenever your bottom 40% are just not doing well. Direct cash transfer again goes in the same direction. And I think many people have been talking about direct cash transfer simply because food grains is one thing, but, you know, you need to generate demand to generate other manufacturing, to revive your manufacturing base. So people were talking about these three measures even before COVID. Input tax relief and, you know, to boost the economy was sort of, you know, in some sense, you are probably, that measure is more related to COVID because certain sectors have really suffered due to COVID. So you want to, you know, small scale manufacturing and MSME sector, you want to revive them. So that probably is related to COVID. But again, even if I was talking about the pre-COVID period, that probably would be one of the, again, as I said, it would be one of the way to revive the economy coming from, you know, by giving money to the poorer section of the population and people who are engaged in that, those kind of occupation, which feeds to the poorer section of the population. Public investment in physical and social infrastructure. Physical infrastructure, you know, public investment, the government has been talking about for a long time. I remember that when Arvind Subramanian was presenting his, you know, economic surveys and so on, that was one point that he would harp on, that we need roads, we need ports, we need sort of, you know, basic infrastructure. So I think that is, has always been there in some, sort of, in some sense in the radar of the government. What hasn't been there in the radar of the government so much, and which COVID-19 showed up very, very glaringly, is that social infrastructure, in particular health. So I think, you know, even before, you know, COVID struck, we were really lagging behind in our, you know, expenditure in terms of education and health. Education, these were never a priority. Now, I'll tell you why that matters, not just for the COVID shock, which was, of course, a health shock. So you need to do something about this. You need to, you know, have more hospitals, more doctors, more you know, health workers and so on. But the point is that even without, when people were talking about this, you know, this idea about whether it's structural and cyclical and so on, I think that people who are saying that it's a structural crisis, people are always pointing towards how lack of land reform and labor reform were sort of, you know, pinning us down to this sort of structural crisis. But nobody ever talked about the fact that our education system is in a dismal state. So we are not actually producing skilled workers the way we should, in the sense that, you know, the focus was always on as if you restructure the labor laws and you can employ more labor, unskilled labor, more cheaply, and therefore that's going to revive the manufacturing sector, which might work in the short run, but in the medium run, given the way technological progress is happening, if you really want to have sustained growth, you have to generate more skilled worker, and a more skilled worker, healthy worker, skilled worker can come only if you look at the social sector. So somehow, I think, you know, COVID brought it to the fore, but even before COVID, this is a strategy which has not been much talked about, that the fact that, you know, education sector is languishing behind. And you know, there were all this very fancy named schemes which were announced, but I think, you know, there were the budget wise and otherwise also, these are the two sectors which have always been neglected for a long time now. And that's something that you point out in your study, but that's something that was probably not there in the discussion before the COVID. So in a way, COVID has brought that to the fore. Suspension of FRBM for 2 years. I have more to say about this, so I'll just come back to this point later. And then also the last point about monetization of central deficits. So, you know, how does one interpret them pre-COVID and post-COVID? Now, I think, you know, all your five schemes, and as I said, these are all needed at that point of time, even before COVID struck us. And now that with COVID, we desperately need this kind of money. Everybody recognizes that we desperately need more, you know, more spending in the fiscal sphere. So, and you know, everybody recognizes that just merely creating liquidity is not going to help us, as you have also pointed out, that, you know, bank, you know, creating more liquidity doesn't necessarily mean that firms are going to take up that extra available credit. So that brings us to the third, your sixth and seventh point, which is that imagine that, you know, if everybody, including people who were earlier, let's say, conservative fiscal conservatives, let's say, you know, people like Raghuram Rajan and so on. So even when people like almost everybody across the board are asking for higher fiscal expenditure, which obviously, given that the revenues are going down, will raise the the government debt and the debt GDP ratio and so on, then why is it that we still see, even in the last, you know, recent budget, that why is it that you still find this kind of hesitancy in the government of not spending? And I think that's where this FRBM and fiscal deficit and all this come in, because I think I believe that after talking to some people in the government and in RBI, is that there is this fear that the moment you start doing that, as if you are going to the whole fiscal dominance kind of outlook will just start getting into the creep into the government policy making, and that eventually is going to hurt our interest, in the sense that that will create the credibility with the foreign investor will go, and people will sort of not make investment and so on and so forth. So foreign investor sentiment seem to be the fear of affecting the foreign investor sentiment seemed to be a dominant one. And that's where I think, you know, in a way, it's so if I was thinking about this pre-COVID, I'd probably worry a little bit about that, because, you know, that might create really an external sector crisis and so on, not probably so much, you know, internal price instability, but external instability. But I think that's where COVID-19 gave us an extra, in some sense, if you like, you know, a positive leeway to look at this extra deficit, because every other country is taking this kind of fiscal stimulus. So when you are thinking about creditors, you know, investor investment, it's not as if by spending more money, India, in a relative sense, you know, compared to other countries, are going to go down in the ranking, even for the credit rating agencies or other people who are looking for channels to investment. So in a way, I feel that those two points about suspend FRBM and monetize central deficit would probably worry me, or worry such, you know, conservative people in the government or in the central bank, you know, pre-COVID. But post-COVID, that's exactly where you get an extra room to maneuver, because, you know, post-COVID, it's so easy to justify that this is only an emergency measure. Every country is doing it, and that gives you an extra headroom to go for those fiscal expenses. So I think your last two points are to be highlighted more. So as I was doing the pre-COVID, post-COVID analysis, I think that these is exactly, every measure will go exactly the same way. This will increase the fiscal burden, obviously, for the government, but this is probably the right time to justify that. And if you do justify that and give the right kind of signal, then the central worry that was bothering the government all along, that, you know, I'm going to adversely affect the foreign investors' sentiment, I think it's right now at this point, it's not so much there. All other countries are doing it. So in a relative scale, we are not really going to do anything which is exactly opposite of what others are doing. So I think that, you know, in that sense, if a foreign investor is looking at all the countries, then India is not going to be an outlier. So that gives an extra room for the government. And I wonder why the government does not want to exploit that. That's exactly why I think your last two points mix special, you know, are specially relevant given the COVID crisis, because it's so easy to justify large scale fiscal expenditure and, if, you know, monetizing them, given that this is an unusual situation, extraordinary time always can justify extraordinary measure. So I think I'll stop that. I think I enjoyed the paper. I think your measures are all make more sense precisely because in the kind of condition we were before COVID, but post-COVID possibly gives us the opportunity to actually, you know, meaningfully take it without much resistance, either internally or externally. So I think if we don't do that, it will be a lost opportunity. So I'll stop there.
Thank you so much for your comments, Professor Das. Let me now invite Roshan to share his views on the paper.
Well, thank you, Tanushree and ORA, for, you know, giving me this opportunity. Let me just, you know, get to it straight away. So, you know, like, you know, Abhijit said in the beginning, you know, the paper probably was written much earlier than, you know, when we are discussing it. So there will definitely be a lag as far as, you know, the statistics, etc., which have been discussed, are concerned. You know, at the outset, let me make it clear that, you know, I agree with the basic gist of the paper, you know, that there has been a demand side problem in the Indian economy even before COVID struck, and COVID is likely to have made that problem only worse. But my comments, you know, because, you know, a significant time has passed, and, you know, we've now had one budget, we now have, you know, some sort of estimates for full year's GDP, etc. So my comments would be more in the form of suggestions, because I assume that this paper ultimately, when it is published, will go one more round of revision. At the current stage, it is in a working paper format. So that is how I'll, you know, that is what will define the spirit of my, you know, comments on the papers. You know, before I get into the details, I think the first thing which all of us have to acknowledge is that, you know, there is one thing which differentiates India today from a lot of other major economies. You know, China probably is the only other exception, is that, you know, we have not had a second wave of COVID-19 infections. You know, whereas if you look at countries in the West, you know, whether it is the United States or countries in Europe, etc., they are all now caught in a very serious second wave of COVID-19 infections, which is actually looking like, you know, I mean, even worse compared to what the first wave was. That, I think, has definitely played a role in, you know, the economy not doing as badly as people expected it to do. You know, if you look at international forecasts also, such as the World Bank, IMF, a lot of private forecasts, they keep getting revised every day. All of them have made an upward revision. Even the RBI's forecast, from 9.5, it came to 7.5. So I think, there's one silver lining in the economy, which is that, as lockdown restrictions were eased and, people started getting to work and, shops and establishments started opening, the fear was that actually cases could revive. Immediately after Diwali, Delhi was witnessing one of its worst waves. That was the most widespread fear. Now we are, one can't say for certainty, but one can say with a reasonable degree of confidence that that doesn't look like it'll happen. And now that we have started a vaccination program also, if women were around, probably, you could have weighed in. I think, in India, it looks more like herd immunity than anything else. All of us have reason to be happy about it. So having said that, I think that is one thing which we have to keep in mind, that the economy might not do as badly as we expected it to do, say, sometime around, August or even September, when, actually the annual forecast started coming in. But the larger question then is, so does it mean that, the worst is over for the economy? That clearly seems to be the official thinking. If you look at the budget, if you look at the economic survey, if you look at the, the latest monetary policy, committee statement, when the RBI governor made his, press statement, all of them seem to believe that the worst is over for the economy. A lot of private, economies, etc., analysts, forecasters, etc., have also argued on those lines. There I am more, in line with, Abhijit's thing. I think, even before COVID struck us, the economy was facing a crisis of demand. And, one thing which COVID, would have, made a dent on is, everybody has been arguing that, the recovery which we have had during the COVID-19, as the economy has started unlocking, etc., a lot of economists are calling it a profit-led recovery. So if you look at the bottom line of, the biggest companies, the biggest corporate houses, even among, quote unquote workers in the economy, the white collared workers have done much better than the blue collared workforce. People like you and me, we have been doing our work, we have been sitting remotely doing our work, and our earnings have not been as badly affected as, say, somebody who was a roadside vendor or who was running a small restaurant or shop or something, or places where there were manual work involved, etc. Even if you look at high frequency indicators such as purchasing managers indices, etc. So whereas the production indicators actually show a revival, they've been going up since October. They've been above that critical threshold of 50. All of those indicators have been noting that actually employment has been going down. So, we have a lot of reason to believe, and unfortunately, there's no official data on this, and and there's no hope that such data would be available, in the near future also. All anecdotal evidence and private estimates suggest that, earnings of, and when I say poor, I don't mean the bottom 10 or 20%. I mean, one can say with a lot of confidence that earnings of top, bottom 60 to 65% of the people in this economy would actually have suffered. Agriculture, people say, has, done well, 3.4% growth and all that. But all of us know that even the rural economy, remittances play a large role. And there's absolutely no evidence to suggest that, even though migrant workers have started going, back to the cities, wages, etc., have not come back to the levels they were before pre-COVID. The fact that, there was a high inflation during this period has clearly not helped real earnings also. So I think that is the basic question one has to track if one is talking of how the economy will do going forward. A lot of economists have been arguing that actually, even if the poor take a hit, it doesn't matter in the economy because, ultimately it is the bottom, top 20% who matter for the economy. There I don't agree. I think a lot of the crisis which the economy has been facing post 2016-17 has been because, the earnings of the, the bottom half of the economy has taken a hit. And, it is their demand which had played a critical role earlier in supporting economic growth. So unless that happens, we can't, expect economic growth to come back to normal. GDP numbers, we might have a number this year. Remember demonetization, the year actually showed in the first estimate showed the highest growth in the new series. And then subsequently, those numbers have been revised downward significantly. So our quarterly numbers, etc., don't actually capture the full scale of activity in the informal sector. And the problem is, of making an academic analysis here is your analysis can be only be as good as the first set of numbers are. So there, I think, the full story is still not out. Now, coming to, the recommendations which he has made, I think if our diagnosis, is common that the earnings of the poorest, 50% have been hit, then definitely you have to take some steps to support those earnings. But I would suggest that there's reason for more nuance when we suggest these measures. And once again, unfortunately, actually as academics, we do not have enough data in this country to make those nuanced recommendations. I mean, we do not have a consumption expenditure survey after 2011-12. It is entirely, it is highly unlikely that people's consumption baskets in 2021 are the same as what they were in 2011-12. So we don't have consumption data. It is very difficult to even guess, is it only rice and wheat when which matter when it comes to people's food consumption. About urban employment guarantee program, I'm completely in spirit that you have to have some sort of a counter cyclical measure, but I'm not sure exactly what format it'll take. I think the rural employment guarantee bit is slightly simpler. The other thing about the input tax thing, I think the government has instituted some sort of a production linked incentives scheme. It is largely for few sectors. But I think we need to keep in mind that the government did announce large corporate tax reductions in September 2019. I mean, then the argument was that businesses would respond with higher investments. I think they did not. And the reason I say this is, in principle, I agree that you have to get rid of the FRBM and, you have to invest, the government should invest more. I think even the government today, no matter what its stated orthodoxy is, the economic survey says clearly that government investment actually crowds in private investment rather than crowds it out, which is, one of the basic debates between the heterodox and the neoclassical schools in macroeconomics. But I think one thing which the paper could do better is to, it should also address the question of resource mobilization for the government. Ultimately, whether you get rid of the FRBM this year or you agree to have a higher fiscal deficit, I think the basic question is, in India, it is, more or less an expected position across the ideological spectrum that the government actually doesn't mobilize as much resources as it should be mobilizing. Our tax GDP ratio has not improved. Policies such as demonetization, GST, etc., were supposed to improve our tax GDP ratio. I think it has ended up becoming worse because tax buoyancy definitely has gone down. So there, I think, we have to think of some sort of a way, to enhance the government's resource position also. And there, I think, we need to revisit, the corporate tax cuts which were given, or, if it is also a question of, rationalizing your income tax rates, etc. So there, the paper could, maybe do something, and, make some, even if they're provocative arguments, because ultimately, it is not just a question of you don't agree to the FRBM. You have to have a sustainable debt trajectory, even if, the government takes debt to finance its current thing. And the last thing, which I'd like to say is, all said and done, there is also a question of politics. We have seen, what the budget did. And, whereas the government is claiming that it is going to give a lot of, capex boost to the economy, etc. If you look at the weight of, those numbers, they ultimately don't. I think, capex was some 1.85% of GDP. Now we'll reach around 2.25% of GDP or something. So, whereas, on their own, the hike on its own, the hike looks very impressive. But I don't think, as far as the larger macroeconomic situation is concerned, it is going to make a lot of difference. So, it also raises the question, as far as I am concerned, as to what is the government's politics or its political economy approach going forward. I think, it used to be, a supply side driven approach where, there was a lot of focus on infrastructure. Then 2016-17 onwards, it also became a pro-formal sector formalization approach. We had demonetization, we had GST. I think even during the COVID crisis, that formalization approach has continued. There is a lot of push on that formalization approach. Even the agricultural laws and the labor sector reforms actually, take us forward in that direction. And, the additional proposal of monetizing, brownfield assets, infrastructure assets, etc., where the government will actually do the initial dirty work of, building infrastructural assets, acquiring land, etc., and then hand it over to the private sector. So, I think, we might be in, headed in a trajectory where we are actually headed from a demand side versus the supply side conflict to, an additional theater of conflict, which is also the formal versus informal sector of conflict. Because, your GDP numbers, there is a lot of controversy regarding MCA accounts, etc. They, I think, are biased in favor of the formal sector. So they might, even the official statistics might show that, they are actually pro-growth. But I think its real effect on the economy, when we finally have the consumption sector numbers or finally, some of the, issues which are independent economists have been raising vis-a-vis the GDP numbers are addressed. I think ultimately this formal sector push which the government has adopted is going to cost us in terms of aggregate demand, mass demand also. So unless the Indian economy addresses those things, and I think the paper, is in that spirit, because its basic argument is that ultimately your growth is dependent on your consumption, and unless consumption rises, nothing is going to happen. Investment, of course, follows consumption. So if consumption is not rising, investment won't rise. So that I think is a larger political economy thread in this paper. And it would be excellent if, you know, the author were to, you know, because, you know, I mean, I think the paper will have to be revised to make for the developments which have taken place. If these comments could be accommodated, it would make for an excellent reading. Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much for your comments, Roshan. Abhijit, I'm going to give you just about 5 minutes to respond to those comments before we start with the Q&A. So over to you.
Do you want me to respond now or let me respond in the last, actually?
Sure.
Open it for the question answer.
I think that would be better.
Probably the panelists will also, you know, have some questions, and then do that. Then I'll couple of minutes I'll take in the end.
Perfect. So let's start with the Q&A. I'm just combining a couple of questions that we received. So the first set of questions is that we're hearing claims about a V-shaped recovery by several government officials and policymakers. How credible are these claims? The second question is that today the stock market seem to be doing really well, but how come it is so contradictory to what's happening in the real economy? And the third question is that it's surprising to see that the Indian government stimulus to the tune of 1.3% is so small versus other economies like the US economy, which has infused about 20 to 25% of GDP through their stimulus package, but it still has a very anemic recovery. So given that, would it be advisable for India to expect another stimulus, and what would be the size of that stimulus? So I would request Abhijit to respond first to this question, or, you know, any of the panelists, whoever would like to go first, can take up these questions.
Let the panelists say whatever they have to. Then I'll do it.
Okay. So since neither of you is volunteering, I would ask Professor Moshimi to take up these questions.
Okay, I'll take the last one first, in the sense that I think it'll be really prudent to jack up the fiscal stimulus. And as you said, as the question also pointed out, and as I was also saying, that, you know, all the other countries in a crisis situation, they do this. And as I said, it would be a pity if the government does not use this, you know, this particular, if I can say, excuse to, and which is needed. And at the same time, it's perceived to be okay, so it should do it. It should really, as Roshan was pointing out, the numbers are not really what they reflect. The numbers are sort of, you know, saying a lot, look a much bigger than they actually are, or their impact is actually are. So it is, I think, you know, if the government is prudent, then it should look at giving more fiscal stimulus, which it has all along been a bit conservative. Even during the COVID crisis, we have seen that, you know, the clamor was for more fiscal stimulus, but it was, you know, it took a long time in coming, and even when it came in a very, you know, sort of in a stopgap measure and in a very, very small amount. So somehow there is a reluctance to venture all out into the fiscal space. And that's something that I think it's not warranted, definitely, at this point. And even given the long medium run trend that we have been seeing over the years, to, you know, in terms of lack of demand, it's not warranted even without COVID. So that's probably my reaction to the second last point. I've forgotten the other two now, but maybe
Roshan. Yeah. So the first was that we're hearing so many claims from official sources that it's going to be a V-shaped recovery. How credible are these?
So that I suppose, you know, it's just as credible as all the numbers that we have been finding from the government or not coming up from the government. So somehow, you know, of late, the numbers coming from the official sources, and as Roshan also mentioned, are all of, you don't know, you know, where they're coming from, you don't know, and most of the time they're not coming. So there's a lot of credibility in terms of the numbers. India used to do very, very well compared to other emerging markets in terms of giving data, very, very well structured data. And apart from the fact that we are faltering on growth, we are faltering on, you know, in terms of equality, we have also been faltering in terms of generating data and numbers. So I think anything these days comes from the government and the official sources are things that you don't know how to take them, how credible they are, including the growth rates that they have been projecting, not just now, even earlier, you know, the kind of revision that they have done. So these are the numbers coming from the government are always have become a little less credible over the years, and that has been happening for a long time now. And that's another worry probably for all of us, including those who are trying to look at those numbers. And what was the second question again? So I would take that with a lot of, not just a pinch, but probably a sack full of salt. But again, there's a political economy there, right? So the government cannot go and say that, no, it's going to be a flat and we are not going to recover. So in some sense, that is understandable, but the numbers are of suspect. And what was the second question again? Sorry, I forgot.
Sure. The second question was that, how is it that the stock market seemed to be doing so well, but the real economy is not mirroring that?
So the stock market, you know, my response to that would be that, you know, that's the dichotomy that we have been seeing for a long time, that, you know, so we had a very buoyant stock market and, you know, many of our formal sectors were doing well and so on. But whereas the economy doesn't consist only about the formal sector and the financing of the formal sector through the stock market, right? So there's a huge, big economy out there, which has been left out from the growth process for a long time now, not just by, you know, last 6 years, but, you know, for last 10 years, 12 years and so on. And I think we are seeing the effect of that now. So in some sense, just looking at making all our decisions, just looking at the stock market and how stock market responds is probably not the right way to look at it, especially because we have been realizing now that ignoring the bottom 40% or bottom 50%, which have been left out, are going to come back and sort of, you know, strike us now. We have already seen that. So at this point, therefore, looking at the stock market to think about how the India is doing is probably not the right way. So I'll just stop here.
Thank you for those great and very balanced answers, Professor. Roshan, would you like to weigh in on those?
You know, let me begin with the stock market first. We have to keep in mind, you know, that the stock market, it is, you know, ultimately, you know, a weighted index of stock prices which are traded in the BSE. Why is the stock market going up? You know, one, I think, you know, a lot of factors other than the real economy actually influence the stock market. The biggest factor, you know, I think, which is responsible for the stock market doing well is interest rates in advanced countries are at near zero levels. You know, there is a lot of money sitting in, you know, advanced capitalist countries, which is actually looking for return. And, you know, relatively speaking, India is a much better option for them rather than the advanced country. There's a lot of money which has been coming in. Even if you look at, you know, the top 5 to 10% of our, you know, households, you know, the pandemic actually created a lot of forced savings. A lot of people who take foreign holidays, you know, spend eating out, etc. You know, that money was never spent, so they've had a lot of additional savings which were parked in the stock market. So those two things are, you know, the concrete, you know, source of money going into the stock market. You know, the other thing to look at it is, you know, the India stock market actually, you know, market movements actually are essentially speculation around stock prices. It is not that, you know, every day, you know, IPOs are floated in the stock market and you actually have money being raised for new companies or new investment ventures. So, you know, this investment doesn't lead to greenfield investment. So that way, the stock market is not, you know, a performance, you know, not a good barometer of what the actual investment scenario in the stock, in the economy is, because it is not being, it is not money which is being invested. Now, even if you looked at, you know, it in terms of, you know, share prices of companies which are being traded, you know, the basic indicator to look at the stock market is, you know, something which is called the price, you know, earnings multiple ratio, you know, the price earnings multiple, you know, which is basically the price of a stock and the earnings, the dividend it offers on stocks. You know, that multiple is actually, it is at highest ever levels. So even if you go, you know, if you judge the stock market by basic levels, it is actually overvalued by all standards. As far as the question of V-shaped recovery is concerned, like I said earlier also, you know, the question is, what is your prognosis of the economy? Is your prognosis of the economy that everything, you know, that with the lockdown ending and infections not rising, you know, everything has been restored? I don't think that is the situation, because a lot of people have taken, a lot of companies have taken a big hit on their balance sheets, and its effects will eventually show when we start getting the informal sector numbers. So I think, you know, if the government is arguing, I mean, as, you know, Professor Das said, that, you know, there is an element of rhetoric. The government can't come and say everything is doom and gloom in the economy. But if it is saying, it probably believes that that is not the case. That is a larger cause for worry for me, more than what the government is saying. So that is what I'd like to, you know, say as far as these two questions are concerned.
Thank you, Roshan. So the question about stock markets was from Atul Patel, and I request all members in the audience to also post their names with the questions when they're posting them. Abhijit, would you like to weigh in?
I'll just, you know, I don't have my, I'll just add us, you know, small things, because what Roshan actually already mentioned, I'll also start with the stock market, because I'll just one simple fact I'll mention, that Sensex is ultimately a, you know, a 30 scrape benchmark. So, you know, it is a fluid kind of a benchmark, and then it, you know, one company, if it does well, it replaces the other company in the top 30, but ultimately that one needs to figure out. But yes, you know, of course, you know, there are a lot of foreign portfolio investors, and on account of that, a lot of money has come. But then, of course, you know, we can't say that that perfectly, forget about perfectly reflecting the entire economic situation. It is, I think, it's a little bit misleading, you know, at one point of time. So, you know, why stock market is doing very well, if you ask me personally, I don't have any idea, because you know it has a lot of other things which actually determine the prices, volatility going up and down, and other kind of things. And we have seen from several instances that, you know, even the prices can be influenced by different kind of factors also. But anyway, then, you know, I'll go to the, you know, the entire recovery, because I really don't understand, because the point is that, you know, you have shut down the economy. A, you have shut down the economy once. B, you open the economy, of course, you know, it is going to go up. And what do you expect? That even if every quarter, if, you know, 5%, 10% of your GDP is getting slashed, then obviously, you know, after a certain point of time, we'll land up in a situation where the economy will be at zero, which is not possible. So obviously, optimism is great. You know, as Professor Das also said, that the point is that optimism is great, and then government cannot always come and say that, you know, no, economy is going down. I can understand that government position also. Government is fully entitled. But I will also reiterate, you know, Roshan's point, that the problem is that probably, you know, the somewhere around, it is not even about, you know, the bottom 10% or 20%, you know, real below poverty line, BPL population. It is not like that, because, you know, this pandemic actually has changed a lot of equation, because there are people who were in fact earning somewhere in the region of 10 to 15,000 to even, you know, 40,000, 50,000, they lost their jobs. Some of them actually got it back also. Some of them are doing something else, because I have my, you know, on very anecdotal level, you know, I have some friends who actually lost their jobs, and they're yet to find it. You know, there are some people who are yet to find it. So it's a very serious kind of a situation. So it's not just like, you know, and some of them, you know, I can mention also, some of them, they were working as, you know, the floor manager in some coffee chain or something like that. They were getting decent amount of money, but then, you know, that they lost their job. So the point is that, you know, when actually we're talking about DBT and other kind of things, this is what we are talking about. And fiscal stimulus, of course, you know, I believe that, you know, what once again the Professor Das said, that it is probably the, and also Roshan also mentioned in the form of political economy, that it is a tug of war between the fiscal versus, you know, that entire monetary, or, you know, monetary slash free market kind of measures, where in fact government does not intervene too much. So, you know, it is something like that. But I really, at this point of time, I don't see, you know, if we go by purely by economics, I don't see any reason that why more fiscal stimulus cannot be given. One additional fact here is also that ultimately, after all kinds of propaganda, the exact amount of fiscal stimulus which were there, which has been in a way, you know, removed in this budget also, pretty abruptly. But then, you know, that percentage was at the most, you know, if you do a very optimistic kind of an estimate, even then it will be somewhere around 2.5 to at the most 3%, you know, of your, you know, contrary to the claimed idea that it is, you know, 10%, 15%, 12%, or it is not that. Most of it is, almost bulk of it is actually credit availability, you know, into the entire monetary system. So it is not going to work. So that is what I have to say.
Thank you. I think it's already 11:30 and we've used up all the time that we had. My apologies to the members in the audience whose questions we couldn't take up. feel free to write to the author and the panelists for your questions. Special apologies to Falguni Biswal, who's posted 3 questions, but we couldn't take any of them. Any closing remarks from the panelists before we wrap up?
Might take a couple of questions if you're giving us closing remarks.
Yeah.
So let me just take maybe 2 more questions.
Sure.
So there's this question about agriculture. So it says that since agriculture is the only sector that has shown growth post-pandemic, should we not double down on ramping up agriculture and increasing its share in the economy? That's one. And another would be that what would be the challenges in universalizing PDS in the country? And, you know, why has it not been done till now in India's economic history if it is such a great measure? So it's open to all of you. Anyone can go first.
All right, I'll take it. We can't increase the share of agriculture in our GDP because that will basically mean going to factories and sowing paddy there. India is in the process of a structural transformation, and it is to be expected that the share of agriculture should only come down. The problem of agriculture is not that its share in GDP is going down. The problem with agriculture is that it is becoming unviable. So even people who practice agriculture actually they don't make profits. I know the government says that it gives MSPs which are 1.5 times the cost of production, etc. But in case this question is from a student, I would actually encourage you to go and look at different concepts of cost of cultivation. And we actually do not take a holistic concept of cost of cultivation when deciding the MSP markup. And as probably the entire country knows now, very few farmers in this country actually realize prices which are equal to MSP. The second question regarding PDS was the biggest challenge, of course, is money, because if you want to increase, universalize PDS, you will probably need, significantly more money. But there, I think, there's reason for nuance, rather than looking at the PDS as something which is only rice and wheat per family. I think ideally we should look at diversifying the scope of the PDS. There is no reason, we can't give vegetables, etc. Pulses, etc. So if we want to increase our food subsidy, we want to increase our PDS coverage, the focus should be as much on diversification as it is on universalization.
Perfect. Thank you, Roshan. Professor Das?
Yes, on the agriculture, the trying to pump money into agriculture, I completely agree with Roshan, and Abhijit also mentioned that in the paper. Agriculture in any country, whether you're thinking about growth process cannot be sustained by focusing on agriculture. So even the demand for agricultural goods, commodities, we all know that eventually it flattens out, right? So this commodity basket eventually moves to other products. So it's not that's not a viable, sustainable process if you're thinking about a growing economy. So agricultural share has to go down in any advanced economy. It just goes down as the economy progresses. I think what is worrying for us is that as the agricultural share was going down, and it's looking great only because other sectors were shut down, right? So it's looking great only in comparison to during the lockdown period, nothing else was working. So that's why it's looking great. But otherwise, the agriculture share, it's not as if that it was not doing great. And then the problem for India is that too many people depend on agriculture, as Roshan was saying, that why it doesn't give us too much in terms of share in output. It employs a huge amount of people, and that has been our biggest worry for us for a long time, that our structural transformation, unlike other countries, has not been accompanied by a movement of people away from agriculture to other sectors. So that has been a very peculiar kind of structural transformation, which is usually does not happen in other countries. So that has been a worry for us, and therefore pumping up agricultural productivity, there's a limit up to which you can do that. And unless you move people out, even if you raise the productivity of agriculture, it's not really going to lead to proper structural transformation. So that's therefore answer to question number one. Question number two was, again, I've forgotten, just remind me a little bit, Tanushree, what was the other question?
It was about universalizing PDS in the country.
So universal PDS. So for a long time, there was a debate earlier, I remember, about what is the best way to reach out to the, develop a social security if you have to have a social security. And I think for a long time, there was a debate about whether you should have a direct cash transfer as opposed universal PDS. So for a long time, right now we are thinking about both of them as a complementary measure, but at one point of time the debate was that whether you need both or one can replace the other. So I think, you know, as Roshan was also saying, if you have to have PDS, one can design it, because implementation and delivery in PDS is always a problem. Direct cash transfer has a, you know, is a direct way of getting into giving an income injection to the people, so that probably works better and direct and easier to deliver. But then again, there was, I remember that there is to be this controversy about whether that will be spent on food items and nutrition and so on. So therefore, probably PDS can be ramped up to the extent there's a self-selection, just like MG Narega. So, you know, MG Narega, people avail only, that's a backup, right? Backup measure. People go and avail that only when other jobs are not available. So if you can make PDS, universal and expand its scope, but at the same time, it's kind of, you know, people have cash transferred and they are going for other products. They can buy it from the market rather than going and availing it from the fair price shops, is probably something that one can think about as a complementary measure. But if there's a budget constraint, then probably there's a scope for thinking about which one is going to serve the greater number of people in a faster way, whether it's need universal PDS or whether it's a direct cash transfer to various people directly, maybe, you know, through the panchayat or whatever. So that's probably where I'm ambivalent about it. I'm not sure that universal PDS is necessarily, this is a crisis period, but otherwise there is scope for combining, or, you know, one or the other and so on. One has to look at the efficacy of the two.
Thank you, Professor. Abhijit, would you like to add something? Otherwise, I'm going to take one more question.
Just a small one, because, you know, on the agricultural share, having agreed to whatever Roshan and Professor Das said, but the point is that our productivity, you know, factually speaking, our productivity is still pretty much less compared to some of the better performing, you know, agricultures in some of the other, you know, including, you know, countries like Vietnam and other places. I am not even talking about, you know, the advanced countries. But then, you know, there is always a, but then problem is that, you know, the research used to get carried out about that productivity earlier in all of the government run research institutes and other kind of things. Those fundings have practically stopped, you know, in the last 15-20 years, those are actually stopped. So we don't have any productivity increase in the agriculture. And that is the conundrum at this point of time facing the entire agriculture sector, that though still, you know, your share in GDP is 15%, or, you know, at the most, you know, 14-16%, but around 50% of your population are actually living on that entire sector. Plus, if you look at the, you know, rural allied kind of activities, then there will be another 5-10% more. So that is the problem. So then I believe that there might be some, you know, innovative thinking which needs to be taken into consideration if one has to. And then one has to put in money for research, you know, somewhere. Privates are not doing it. You know, people actually say that private will be doing it, but private are specifically interested in selling their own kinds of seeds, you know, all kinds of seeds which they can sell year after year and, you know, season after season, all those kind of things. That is a fact. So on the question of PDS also, once again, there are two, you know, slightly nuanced, you know, opposite kind of views have been put up by Roshan and Professor Das, definitely. But what I believe is that apart from all those points which have been mentioned from the both sides, there is another factor is that PDS, in fact, universal PDS, if it is diversified, as Roshan suggested, then it has got a very big influence on the price level also, particularly the food price level. Because, you know, if there is an effective mechanism in which actually you can somehow, you know, control the entire food inflation. And here, in fact, in the background and in the context of what we are talking about, where actually a lot of extra money is getting pumped into the system, and then there will be a lot of fear, though I don't fully agree with that view, but anyway, in the policy making, my view is not important. In the policy making, the, you know, the all important view is that ultimately, if you pump in a lot of money, then of course, you know, there will be an upward pressure on the inflation. So if that is the view, then obviously an universal PDS will be a very good weapon in your hand to somehow, you know, to suppress that food inflation and allied different kind of inflation. If you look at the data, definitely, you know, most of the times, I'm not saying that there are no exceptions, but in most of the times, either it is oil or it is food. You know, when actually you are having inflation, either it is oil prices going up and then or it is the food prices going up most of the times.
Okay, so I think I'll just take one last question from Ashish Bharadwaj from Jindal Global University, who is asking that the share of financial, real estate and professional services has increased in percentage terms from Q1 2019 to Q1 2020. From 24.3% of GDP to almost 30% of GDP. And this is given in table one of Abhijit's paper. He's asking how reliable is the booming financial services, fintech or e-payment industry as a source of economic recovery? There are serious regulatory slash legal challenges that this nascent sector is facing. What are your recommendations on that front? Abhijit, would you like to take this?
Here, in fact, it will be a very short kind of a thing. Mm-hmm. Because what I believe, the first point is that ultimately, as I keep on saying, that you know, your brick and mortar economy, once you know, if you make payment, all kinds of, not only, you know, I am not talking about only the fintech or, you know, the cutting edge kind of new internet based kind of payment system where in fact money goes through an app to other places, to somebody's bank account and vice versa and all those kind of things. I'm not even talking about all those sophisticated things. I'm talking about, you know, money changing hands from one person to another. That only happens when actually there are a lot of activities. If I don't, at a very, you know, layman's level, at a very, you know, typical, you know, in a person like me would like to say that at my level, you know, if I have income, then obviously, you know, I will send money to somebody, say XYZ somewhere, you know, I will send back some money home. Then obviously, you know, I'll make some online transaction. All these things will happen once I have some amount of income. And to get that amount of income, obviously I have to, you know, the economy has to generate some kind of an employment. And once you generate those kind of employment, only then it is actually possible. That is point number A. Second is that if your, this is also related to the first point. If your brick and mortar economy is not doing well, then obviously after a certain point, what actually happens if your brick and mortar economy does well, then with a certain amount of time lag, it might be, I'm not very sure, because you know, one has to look at the reliable literature and reliable data also. But probably after 6 months or 1 year or whatever, you know, after 3 months, 6 months or 8 months, you will see a spurt in the financial activity. Same thing will happen if your economy is not doing very well, brick and mortar economy is not doing very well, then obviously with a time lag, those services will also start taking the hits. And, you know, here we are having a very extraordinary kind of a situation where there are a lot of pent up demands, and then people were not doing some kind of transaction earlier. They actually did in the month of August, September, October, and those kind of things. After that, data need to be checked, and only then we'll have at least some amount of idea about what is happening or not.
Thank you. Any inputs from Professor Das, Roshan?
Yeah, just quickly, you know, share went up because, you know, banks didn't close during lockdown. Most financial institutions did not. Rest of the economy went down. So if the denominator went down and the numerator even stayed constant, share will go up. You know, that's as simple as that. The second thing is, you know, of course, you know, I am all for digitization, you know, financial services, etc. It has made life very convenient, right? From making payments. You know, when we were students, we used to get demand drafts from home. You know, clearly today students don't have to bear with all that. So life is convenient. But, you know, everything has a flip side. You know, if you've, you know, looked at, you know, off late, there's been a lot of reporting about how these online lending apps, you know, flourished during the lockdown, and they've been charging interest rate which is up to 30%, 40% per month. And, you know, they have been employing thugs to harass people, etc. So regulation, I think, is of, you know, paramount importance, and that is one area, you know, I think where we, you know, so SEBI has done well. You know, all said and done, India's stock market is far more better regulated than it was. I think, you know, the banks, the RBI, etc., they all have, you know, there's still a lot of, you know, regulatory curve to be, you know, conquered. So there, I think we have to be very careful about, you know, we should make sure that, you know, none of this growth actually ends up, you know, being predatory about, you know, against poor people's incomes, etc. That is all.
Right. Thank you, Roshan. Any comments from Professor Das? Okay.
I just want to, just as a general observation is that, when we talk about banking and financial sector and so on, we have to probably remember that in Indian economy, there's a large population which still doesn't, don't function through, despite all those Jandhan accounts and so on. So there's a large part of our people who are left out of this financial sector. And therefore, and even demonetization was supposed to make people go to, digitization and so on, and that hasn't happened. We know that behavioral shift even among the other people, more well-to-do people hasn't happened. So in a way, I'd be a bit wary about focusing only on those sectors which are probably availed by a very small chunk of the population when we are actually talking about an entire economy, not only from welfare perspective, but as everybody pointed out in this discussion, in terms of sustainability of growth. Unless you can engage the rest of the population, eventually that's going to come and pinch your growth possibilities. So there's no getting away from that. So that's why we do probably need measures to look at those bottom 40 or 50%, not for them. So it's not necessarily a welfare matter, it is, but also for us, for the rest of the population, because otherwise I think growth prospect is doomed. So that's probably the biggest lesson that comes out of the recent discussion, as well as through Abhijit's paper. So I'll stop there.
Thank you, Professor. With this, we'll be wrapping up today's session. Thank you so much, panelists, for taking out time and staying on for extra 15 minutes and answering questions that the audience put up. To members in the audience, thank you for joining in and actively engaging with us. If you have any more questions that haven't been answered, please feel free to reach out to the author and the panelists. Thank you for the great presentation, Abhijit. Have a good day, everyone. Thanks again.
Thanks, Tanushree. Thank you, Abhijit.
Thanks. Yeah, thanks.